This is by no means an exhaustive list of everything, because there are loads of bugs for Florida you can't get away from. There's some that like citrus more than others, but we get a whole heck of a lot of bugs in citrus. So I did put a hash sheet in the pages, and I'll call attention to that when I get to that bug. So the way that I like to think about citrus insects, when I'm thinking about management questions and who I have, I like to think of them in three big categories. There are disease vectors, our direct fruit damagers, and then the ones that primarily damage foliage. And for me, that kind of categorizes them into how I'm going to have to deal with them and who it might be, the severity of it. So the primary disease vectors that we're going to have in citrus is going to be Asian citrus psyllid, which we get a chance to choose in the nymphs, and I accidentally brought in a few adults too, so hopefully I'll find that home with you. But they're everywhere in Florida at this point, so you kind of unfortunately have to deal with them. They are the vector for vulnerable bean, the citrus greening, which we know is a pseudobacterial bacterial disease. There's brown citrus aphid, I have four fast citrus on there. Toxoplasma cicada. This vector is citrus disease virus, which Dr. Kimmy was talking about, and the symptoms are quick decline. It's not hugely problematic right now, but folks have been, for some reason, painting on sour orange root stock again, and we're seeing the virus, and we're seeing the pest. Any aphid can technically vector that virus. This one's just really interesting at it. So we try to watch out for that thing, and like Megan said, prefer people to not use sour orange root stock if possible. And then also this little guy at the very bottom, kind of hard to see. They're very, very, very tiny. It's just called spider mite. Unfortunately, I don't have any for you today because I was up sick yesterday, so I didn't get a chance to go hunting for them in the field. They are extremely small little mites. In the continental U.S., they are really just a pest. They cause some blemishes and nutrients. We'll talk about them a little more later in this talk. In other countries, they do vector a really nasty virus called citrus dispersal virus. We hope that it never gets here, but the reality is that it's a global community. Things are at it. And so we like to get to know that, hey, this is is, and I'll show you pictures of what the virus looks like later, and what the just in general pest feeding looks like when we get to the mite section. Again, we do not have the virus in the U.S. yet, and we're hoping to keep it that way. So some of our fruit damagers with the direct fruit damage. This past year, so yeah, we've been doing over a year, but I had a couple calls about some really nasty fruit damage that people had thought originally was something else, and then as they were describing it, I started asking questions. Is it brown spots, kind of a circular ring coming out from it? And they thought it was bacterial, but they couldn't find it. That was the same, I believe. They couldn't find it on the leaves, and so I started asking questions. Is it smushy? Is it smell funny? And we wound up finding out that we had quite a few problems with stink bugs and leaf footed bugs, so I have some examples on the figures when we get over there. And that's a really big problem because they basically insert their stylet into the fruit and they open a hole. Anytime you leave a hole in a fruit, you need openings for other stuff to get in. And in that case, you have fly larvae in there, bacteria in there. I've been seeing bunga, but I'm sure I can't even put that out. Just got it and then tossed it. So this is a huge problem for fresh green juice fruit. And it's pretty easy to see. The symptoms are very, very clear. We can see it no matter not. Recognize it. It's basically a brown spot. It's pretty cool in the middle. And then it's kind of smushy around it. And concentric rings coming out from there. And then it's also rotting away underneath. I think Dr. Davies had a few samples that brought into the lab this year. I don't know why this year was so weird, but apparently it was a high population. And then we also have the guys that just do damage to appeal. So these cosmetic, this kind of damage behind me. You can still eat that fruit. The fruit's totally fine. It just doesn't look pretty. So there are actually some markets that will still sell these. Apparently has gotten the citrus, so some people will still eat stuff that isn't perfectly pretty. These are the guys that I was talking about with the problem for our direct fruit damage that we have a lot of this year. Stink bugs and leaf-footed bugs. And if you look at them on the underside of them, this is a stylet. This is what they pierce the fruit with. They pierce in, do some saliva, and they start sucking up the fruit contents. And they feed on all sorts of fruit like this. Same over here with the leaf-footed bug, and they cause nice holes. This is that brown, soft, squishy spot, and it is very distinct. Nothing else looks quite like it. And you will get this spot in some of those in the clinic. You're going to see it. You'll see another fruit too. They like everything. They feed on tomatoes, although the tomatoes are rot much quicker. Peaches, blueberries, strawberries, you name it, they enjoy it. They apparently have communication fruit. citrus rust mites, which I also don't have an example of either, but they're crazy small, and apparently my management trial is working, so I don't have any live plants at the moment. They're very, very small little critters. If you see the damage on the fruit, which is really they cause this bronzing appearance on your fruit. Basically, they scar the top of the fruit when they're feeding. And we're just past the peak of their population. They kind of build up all summer. They really like it nice and hot and dry. And they really get cooking, and then we start to get the rain, and it's getting knocked back a little bit. We'll get a second peak in the population in the fall when we hit another dry spell. But they're pretty easy to find if you start seeing damage on your fruit. What I usually tell people to do is to look at the fruit and hold it half in the dark and half in the light, and you turn it a little bit. You see them like the light, so they're going to run towards the dark. You see something really small moving really fast to the dark side, you got rust mites. You're not going to recognize them. They're weird looking. Yeah. So that was actually how I was taught it. And I was like, well, that makes sense. A lot of times they're really small. They're very weird looking little things. They don't quite look like any other mite. They kind of stick a little cone with eight legs coming out one side of them, and they move really darn fast. They can also cause some problems with your leaf growth. If you get a high population, they'll appear in your leaves, they'll appear on your flowers, if there's flowers present, and they just cause a whole bunch of damage. The fruit is not picky about what they feed on, they don't come up with fruit, and they prefer the fruit on it. And you're probably never going to notice the eggs. They're very tiny. They look like little water flicks, not even droplets. And we also have pink citrus rust mite. Honestly, it doesn't matter which rust mite you got. They're both annoying. They both cause similar damage. It's just their populations peak at different points in the year. Pink citrus rust mite builds up a little bit earlier than citrus rust mite. They keep the fruit on the fruit and flowers, and they move on to the fruit as soon as the fruit's available. They cause leaf loss. You get high pressure, so they're feeding on the leaves, causing a bunch of damage. Both rust mites do this. And they can lead an early feeding on fruit, leading to some really ugly fruit. For the most part, the fruit's still edible. It's just really, really ugly. If you get a super high population, you can actually lose some fruit. But for the most part, it's just really ugly fruit. Which, I mean, we'll all eat ugly fruit, right? Not too bad. Our common mealybug, and you have another mealybug in front of you that I'm going to get to right after this guy. This is the most often seen in citrus. It's Pennypocket citrus, which is common citrus mealybug. We also have one, the Spinus, which has a long little tail behind it. I think it's kind of cute, but it's definitely not cute to feed on your food, on your plants. They're really common in the early spring, or the spring or early summer, but you won't find them year round because they have a lot of hosts. They move between trees, move between crops. They like the sheltered locations, so if you find the spots where trees are touching, where there's trees on top of it, a lot of times that's where they'll hang out. And they have a really high population capacity, so they pop out a whole lot of eggs. Every female lays between 300 and 600 eggs in a good scenario. So they can be problematic quite fast, and if you never had to deal with bees at home, you can know that they're a pain in the butt. Most of the time, you're going to want to just prune them out and get rid of them. Toss them in the trash. Don't toss them in your yard waste because they're just going to proliferate in there. And come back out, just get rid of them. I freeze them, personally. Freeze them for a couple days, and then get rid of them. That's how I kill most of my bugs, because that's what I do. They cause a lot of cosmetic damage. They also will cause a lot of that honeydew that Megan was talking about. They don't necessarily cause the honeydew per se, it's just that when they feed, they take in a whole lot of water and carbohydrates that comes out the rear end of the sugar part. And then that sitting mold develops in the sugar water, and you get huge swaths of it blocking photosynthesis. A lot of times, if you have a whole bunch of sitting mold in your home garden, field, wherever you're at, look up and you're going to find the source. And if you can figure out who's causing all that honeydew and take care of them, it's much easier to get that sitting mold under control and clean up the field. One of the major problems we often have with them is actually in grapefruit. For some reason, grapefruit is much more susceptible to citri than the other varieties, and it will often drop from their feeding. And then this guy. This is what I put on your desk. So you guys are all master gardeners, and you're going to be helping people out. This is something that has popped on our radar in the last few months. It is a new invasive species in the state. Yay. Florida is great for invasive species. We have a wonderful climate. We are a hub for exchange of fruit and vegetables. So this pest is known throughout the world as Hippocampus viridis. It has lots of common names. DPI decided that they like the common name of a mealybug. So we are working with them on this project on understanding them. It has a very wide host range. We know of at least 45 plant families and 114 genera within those plant families that they were feed on, and that is from studies in other countries. So we are just now starting to understand what they were used here in the U.S., and especially here in Florida, which is kind of a happy spot for them in their climate zone. They excrete a whole lot of honeydew, and that's how we've been finding them most of the time in field, is to see a seed patch of honeydew, and we look up, and we look around a little bit, and you look at it to scale, but then you see this massive clump of white and black clump, you know where it is, these guys. For young trees, they can actually kill the young trees. I have some in my, I have a room where we rain these, and they've actually sucked the young tree dry. It's just a little twig with other masses of them. And then the mature trees, you're going to get physical damage to the fruit, which makes the fruit unmarketable. And also, there's a lot of fruit drop. So the pictures that I have here, these are actually, all those little specks are mints that have come out of those insects. They, one female produces about 1,000 eggs in her couple-week lifetime. And so they can get to really, really high numbers really, really fast. And people didn't know what they had. This was just diagnosed kind of spot nutrition scale for about a year and a half before I got here, and a grower sent in some samples. And I looked at it in the microscope and I said, I have no idea what the thing is. And got in touch with the scale expert up at EPI because it's a weird mealybug, and it looks more like a scale in some life stages and more like a mealybug in other life stages. Which is kind of interesting if you collect taxonomy there very closely related. This is a nymph, an older instar nymph. They start getting really waxy in their later instars. In the young instars, they don't really have that much wax on them. So the younger instars, what we're seeing, are the easier ones to kill. So we're trying to work with a lure company to develop a lure to help us time their populations so that we can actually time all of our spray applications in the field to when the younger nymphs are available. But everything we've seen in the lab is we spray them when they're young to die. We spray them when they start waxing up or when they're completely inside their oversack, which is a huge waxy ball. We can't kill them. So they're really challenging to manage. And to add complications to that, ant collect them a whole lot. So ant collection farm them and protect them from natural enemies, and they will stay new, which my fruit crew is not enjoying right now. They will also move them between species, so they will move them host to host, and that is a huge problem. It's very easy to move on equipment, very easy to move on accident on your own. With the growers that we've been working with, they are all sterilizing their equipment when they come out of the field with a bleach water mixture, and changing shirts if possible, while the guys are wearing gloves. We'll work with the silver. They know it's clean before they go in the room, and they know there's an infestation. We're trying not to move it. We're trying to really minimize where it's located right now. And right now, I think we're up to 6 counties where we've had positive hits on it. So we're working with EPI. They're doing surveys. But please, if you see stuff, if you see any of this weirdness come into your clinic, please get that sample sent into DPI. It needs to go to the Gainesville office, which I think I have a slide at the end of it that explains how to submit samples. And it gets confirmed by their taxonomist, and then their search people on the ground will further search that area, and it comes to me from the management. So there's 3 of us working together. We each have our jobs, and we're being constantly talking to each other. If we really could use your help with the guys out there, things coming to you. The grower is who actually found it, because he saw these weird fruit. The mealybugs actually inject a toxin when they feed, and they cause this weird deformation, which will cause your fruit to form funny, and you get a whole lot of fruit drop. So that's a really big problem. If you get this infestation, you're going to lose a lot of fruit. Alright, so now that I've done the scary one, there are some extra disease up front if you want to take a few home with you, or you know, if you're off with you, we have information sheets online too that I can email to them in my talk. So moving on to scale pests, these are super common citrus. Everybody loves to see on citrus because it's delicious. Scales are no exception, and historically scales have been under really great biological control in the state of Florida. In the 70s and 80s, there's a huge program to bring in their biological control agents, which are these tiny little wasps like that one guy. And they basically come in, they lay their eggs inside the female, the eggs are produced, they come out through these emergence holes, you see it behind me. There's a little hole in the scale that means somebody popped out of there, flew out of there. A lot of times they've been perished, which happens. We don't know what the state of biological control agents in commercial citrus is right now, only because we've had to spray so much to try to get our spillage under control. We're not recovering parasitoids like we expect to be, so that's actually a big question right now in commercial production, is are parasitoids still there? I'm hoping in the homeowner assistance that you guys still have more of these, so you're not going to be spraying too much on the spray. another one of the common scales that we see is Florida red scale. So there's a Florida red scale and there's a California red scale. This is what we see most of the time down here. For some reason, Georgia's been seeing the California scale. I don't know why, but they send me those. It's kind of this neat little scale. It's got the red center on it, black outer edges. It's very distinct. It doesn't look like anybody else. You see the leaves, the twigs, the fruit, they're really not picky. And they cause this distortion, or restored color on the feet, on the fruit when they fed. Fruit is still edible. It just doesn't look so pretty. It's kind of, if you don't mind what your fruit looks like, you just delete the fruit. Purple scale is really common, and unfortunately, I think they disposed of my tree that had purple scale over it yesterday, so I don't have any demos for you guys back there. But they can be a major pest. For the most part, they've been gotten under control in the last 60 years or so. In the 50s, they did this huge parasitoid introduction, and those parasites seem to persist quite well in the system. And so that means they must be finding some other places to parasitize people who are using the immune systems to keep going in their populations and keep killing the bad guys. They're very distinct. They kind of look like a mussel shape, and they're this browny purple. I kind of wear more of a brown name in there because I think they look more brown than purple. The chaff scale, we don't see a whole lot in the field. You might see it more in homeowner gardens. We see it in some of the cup systems. If you're in the trunk in the inner canopy area, they cause this interesting spotting on your fruit. They're really slow to reproduce, which actually makes them great for areas where you have the parasitoid. The parasitoid can come in and take care of business before the scale can actually become build up the high end of population to be incredibly damaging, which they have problems with that in other parts of the different producing regions. So this is one that you probably will not encounter, but if you do see it in some of your lesions, there are ways to control it, and I'll get those up before you do this. Thrips. I know you guys all know thrips. They're a pain in the butt. We have a couple different varieties of thrips that we deal with in citrus. We have flower thrips, orchid thrips, greenhouse thrips. Who cares who they are? They all do similar damage, and they're all really annoying to deal with. One of the biggest challenges with thrips is that they use both the plant and the soil in their life cycle. So you only really see the stuff that's above the soil. You see the adult seeding, you see the roots feeding up there, but they actually pupate in the soil. So people get really high infestations with thrips. If they have potted plants, one of the easiest things to do after they feed the plant eventually is to change out the soil, because then you're going to get rid of pupae. And that's a very simple step. Now, if it's plants in the ground, that's a little more challenging, and most people aren't going to want to do any type of ground treatment. They don't absolutely have to. Just know that is a really nice option for potted plants, and that you see a lot of that more in nursery settings or in the field per se. Another major challenge with thrips is that they move around a lot. They're not the best flyers, but they can pick up a breeze and move pretty easily between different plants. So they use grasses, they use flowers, they use citrus trees, they use oak trees. Anything that's out there that has foliage, they're pretty happy to feed on. And they're really incredibly annoying critters to deal with. And here's part of the problem with citrus, is that you get this nasty scarring on the fruit. So this is a study that was done by my predecessor. And basically what he did is he took young fruit and he caged them where there were no thrips present, 10 thrips present, or 25 thrips present, so you could watch the progression of damage on the fruit. As you can see, there's no damage, just a little bit of damage, and there's a lot of damage. Honestly, that higher amount of damage, your fruit's probably going to get aborted. So at a high thrips pressure, people will have some problems with fruit abortion. If you've never seen live thrips, this was from behind the station this summer in one of our grooms. This is a little bit of flower thrips hanging out in the petal, but they're going to cause some problems. And a lot of times we see these circular rings, these halo rings. That's thrips feeding damage, and that happened early on in the fruit development process. Again, still edible, just not pretty. The other type of damage you'll get is from some of these bulky greenhouse thrips. They like to feed with the cuts and see with these little ring spotting, as they like to call it. But you get this nasty little spot on there, and sometimes it'll become a little bit soft and indented. You're probably never going to be able to sell that fruit. It's pretty darn ugly, and there's tough spots, actually, on some of those feeding spots. I have not seen this in the field yet, so I don't know how common it is in the field, but it's probably something that happens a little more in state quarters. Going on to our foliage damages. Most foliage damages are not a problem in mature trees. They're more of a problem for immature trees. Young stuff, new pruning things, problems, and those problems with the lichen on the first flush, that nice fresh bright green, full of nitrogen, the lichen is resurface. And so that's where the young trees are more heavily impacted, but we do watch them on the adult trees for various reasons, disease movement, and for making sure that the populations aren't going to decimate your young trees. So here's everybody's favorite beast, Asian citrus psyllid, the adult, and the nymphs. And I have several of the nymphs back over there for you. The nymphs have this neat little waxy secretion that comes out the rear end. If you have a high population, you see a whole lot of those waxy secretions. That's basically honeydew in a slightly different format, more sort of a wax. So this is who picks up the HIV bacteria by feeding. The patient's sucking mouth parts, put their little mouth part in, suck away, pick up the bacteria and move it between the plants. Not every psyllid is going to transmit bacteria as efficiently as the other ones. There's all sorts of data talking about different life stages requiring it better than others, but in theory, they all have the capacity to move it. So there's these problems not just removing bacteria, but they also cause a lot of problems with grease dispersion in the straw. So if you get a really high feeding pressure, you'll actually lose some of your small petals at the top of the tree. I have some good pictures of that, but I could not bring them to this particular top. So if you get really heavy feeding pressure, you will get a lot of abort leaves. And part of the challenge with these guys is that they reproduce throughout the year. Florida, most of the year is a pretty great place to get a bug. They will slow down in the wintertime and reproduce at quite that capacity in the summer, so it's actually a great time to try to manage it. Oil sprays and whatnot, if you want to try to suffocate them. But they're pretty hard to manage throughout the year. If you're a homeowner, there is a dooryard citrus release program for Cambria thuringiata, which is a parasitoid disease, so it affects. They have a program where you can sign up and get vials of tamarack CSFT for dooryard leeches. And tamarack is a great, okay, I need to see that. Tamarack is a great vial of control. I'm going to talk about bugs, it's fun. This is leaf miner. We have several examples of the trees that I brought over that have some fresh leaf miner in it. You'll look for that, what I like to call a peep trail. See that nice brown trail in there? That is a fresh pit trail with a larva right there. You often find them in the springtime, but in this part of Florida and South, they're around year-round. They're just more abundant in the spring. The adult is super-duper tiny. I have some back there for you. She is nearly impossible to see in a canopy. You're never going to find that thing. But if you start seeing the damage, then you probably need to think about some management options for it. It's a little harder in the homeowner situation compared to something you can grow if it's going to work, or you can't use. Not able for home use, I should say. One of the easiest things you can do is clean it out. That damage is really obvious. Clean it out and destroy it. And you're going to take some of the larvae that you can do in the next generation of adults out of the system and you can have some problems. We do that in our greenhouse all the time because you can't really spray in there. So we just go clean out the leaves and try to reduce the pressure. One of the biggest challenges with these is that, much like the leaf-footed bug and the stink bug, when they poke a hole in and get their feeding going on, when they're feeding, they're also creating holes in the tissue. When you create holes in the tissue, you can let other things in. And so actually, the canker bacteria can very efficiently move in through those holes if there's a good wind or rainstorm, and they get moved around on it. So there's usually a loop between citrus leaf miner and canker because they make all of the holes. Bacteria gets in through the holes, gets in the leaf, gets in the tree. And that's one of the main reasons you need to control these. Mature trees, they're not as problem besides the paper. Immature trees, they can reduce the place of the capacity of the person the tree is not going to make. Or if it does, it's not going to be a very happy tree. This is one of the next one up is orange bug caterpillar. This is something everybody loves to hate. In young trees, the caterpillar can completely destroy your tree. Mature trees, again, can handle some damage because it's chewing pests. They like that fresh foliage the best. They'll chew on anything that they have to, but the fresh foliage is ideal. They smell like bird poop. That's, you know, their goal is to camouflage themselves. They can eat meat away. And they also, when they also use bacteria that pop out, they have a funny smell and a toxin associated with it. So you put on their hands, wash your hands. They're not going to hurt you. They rear up like snakes to try to scare you, and that bacteria just looks like a tongue. But they won't hurt you. I just pick them off and squish them. With their liquid water in the ground. It's the easiest way to manage them, just to physically remove them. And then those that do survive, you get this beautiful butterfly. This is actually a pollinator. So, you know, it's like a balance of my pollinators and my pests. This one's both usually I just say get rid of them, just toss them on the ground. Not necessarily going to spray, it's going to have effect on them. You see what's the most powerful, and I haven't seen it be particularly great for these guys. Another one that everybody complains about around here is the eastern rubber grasshopper. You can't live in Florida and not know this thing. See the black stages of it, black and red, black and yellow. These are all just nymphs to be taken even out, even though they eat like crazy. And then this is the adult down here with the yellow and the cool red underwings. They eat everything. Everything. And if you're ever out here in July, you're going to be eating all of our different plants out every morning. They are nearly impossible to control, to be completely honest. We'll say there's always things that are labeled that spray for them, but they are really good at not eating things that are supposed to kill them. So what we usually tell people to do is just specifically mechanically remove them. Pull them off themselves. I've experienced by several of our researchers here. They have lost entire acres to these guys in the spring. The choice is to handle some damage, and the acres really just can't take it. Aphids, again, we'll come back to these guys. So these are the spiraea aphids that I found in a field nearby here. They are problematic on these fresh leaves. They like the nitrogen in it. They'll cause all sorts of weird curling and distortion. They make a lot of honeydew, which means you have a certain mold associated with them. They can actually decrease the photosynthetic capacity of your leaves, which is a problem. And they also, like I said, anything can move to save the virus. Brown citrus aphid is the most efficient, but any aphid technically can acquire it and move it. Some are just better than others. The great thing with aphids is that everybody likes to eat them. So every predator on your system pretty much is looking for these guys. So if you see lady beetles out there, you can zoom around looking at these aphids. Spider mites, which I have a nice population of over there. We have a whole bunch of kinds of, we have three different spider mites that are pretty common around here. The citrus red mite, Texas citrus mite, and then the six spotted spider mite. Same deal to get two spider also, it depends on where you're at. The dry conditions that we get in the summer before the rainy season starts is really that a happy time for them. They like it dry, they like it hot, and they build up in really high numbers. If you get a really high population, you're going to lose a bunch of leaves. And that's not really great considering we have other problems with your leaves. Some of the other soft scale pests, the foliage, you'll see black scale, those this summer actually. Brown soft scale is really common. Green scale, cotton cushion scale, we actually got a couple of those in our season. So the first time I've been able to see them in my career, which is for me, it's like, oh, this is exciting. There's really cool opportunity to see there. But all of these scales, aside from being annoying, they all create a whole lot of honeydew. Have a predator in the system that'll manage them if you have predators around. Most of them can also be suffocated with a horticultural oil in a home situation. So the one thing I also really want to point out in addition to the pests, we have a lot of good bugs out there. I'm not going to talk about the pollinators because most people know and love their pollinators, but I want to talk about the predators because these are my favorite and they're really important for pest management. So we have a kind of a big here of generalist predators from all lady beetles. This is actually a larva of one of the lady beetles, if you can remember this guy. That's a lynx spider up there, a couple different spiders. Long-legged flies, which are amazing predators of soft-faced insects. I couldn't resist this guy, he's just adorable. Big-eyed bugs and earwigs over here. They're all really great generalist predators. They will eat anybody soft and squishy. So they're going to go after your aphids, your solidness, all those things that are super annoying to deal with, they want to eat. So if we can promote them, that's a good thing. Having some habitat to promote your natural enemies is really helpful in pest management, especially in urban situations. You guys have more control over that than in big production fields. Then we also have to eat the specialist predators. And so, some of the ones that, these are actually one of my absolute favorite predators. I'm really excited that I get to work with them right now. These are mealybug destroyers, but they're just not mealybug. They're a specialist lady beetle. They focus on mealybugs. And so, the larva actually kind of looks like a mealybug, but it has much more organized wax. And this is the adult. They are incredibly small. And this is a picture you can do a microscope to, because they are really tiny beetles. but they do an amazing job at eating mealybugs, and they can get right through the wax. And that's one of their specialized mouth parts, get right through the wax in the mealybug, and they will recruit those infestations. So where we've been seeing high populations of antibiotic mealybug, we've actually seen some nice populations established of these predators, and they do a really good job in the field that they've been able to establish. And we haven't been able to establish this on because there's such a high dollar field we had to take care of the field. And then tumor T. radiata is what I mentioned earlier for psyllids. So this is a psyllid nymph that has been chewed through, and this is Tumor T. radiata. She's come out, she's done her job. Basically what they do is they come in and they lay their egg on the underside of the nymph. They hatch into a larva that feeds on the psyllid nymph, feeds right underneath it, sucking at your eye, and then it keeps it, and it comes out a hole through the top of it. And then they pop out and they go do their thing in another field. They find a mate, make a baby. They are introduced predators, and so you're not going to generally find these established naturally. They don't stick around. Unfortunately, they haven't really had great establishment rates here, but you can request them. So if you know you, as a homeowner, you want to use these, you can put a request in the pet box to get them. So here's the question, what do I do about all my pests? Most homeowners are not going to have access to the chemicals they use in grows, and I really wouldn't suggest that most of them use them because they require special use and knowledge of what can happen with the system. I'm a big fan of cultural controls for motor management. Providing habitat for your predators is always ideal, something that's going to get them some food resources, floral resources, water resources. Mechanical removal, remove them, remove infested plant parts, you can put it out some of this stuff. Squish them if you can, stomp them if you want to, toss them in soapy water, they're going to drown. Those are really easy things you can do. One of my friends in the West, she and her daughter actually have a Japanese beetle pruning contest. So they just have buckets of soapy water and they tie to see how many Japanese beetles they can actually remove and toss in water. And this is like an ongoing competition, and usually one of the questions that the daughter wins. If her daughter wins, she takes her out for dessert. If mom wins, she just be chores around the house. So, you know, it can be a game. It can be a family as well. You can get T. radiata for solid control from FFCPI. The link is very, 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 very tiny. It is in the bottom of your PowerPoint, and if you can't read it, you can email me and send it to you. Not a problem. Or you can see it on your own too. It's there. And then there's some chemical options. These are ones that we usually say for homeowners. I totally forgot kale and clay, and I'm glad we can mention it. I don't know why I forgot that. But there are a lot of things we use better in home gardens because they're used along with cultural controls. So if you deal with cultural management and along with horticultural oils, you make soaps, dietary fruit, kale, and clay, they're really nice options for homeowners. You're not going to have to use anything too nasty with the system. You have to worry about your pests, or your pets, sorry, and your neighbor's pets getting into it. Horticultural oils do a great job of suffocating pests. All those soft, squishy guys, just suffocate them. The soaps do a nice job of the same thing. We use a lot of impede in one of our greenhouses because it's a fairly safe soap that we can put in the water. Just make sure if you're going to use the soap that's safe for soap, and you read the label and you do the dilution. I learned that the hard way in graduate school because I didn't know what I was doing and I burnt the plants really good. So don't do like me. Read the label. The tenacious earth can work very well. Drilling can work very well. Some of those you're going to need specialized equipment to apply. Going to be a sprayer of some sort, but I use earth and inhaler to use a plug up the sprayer too. So just know if you're spraying something, it stops working. A lot of times it's clogging up with particles, and that can be flushed out really easily. And I think, see me, I'm under time. So I actually have some time to take questions, and I have some bugs to share with you guys too. She asked me if you should use the clay and the diatomaceous earth more in the dry season, yes, because they do wash off. So those are really nice options for dry season, and then you can supplement with some of your other materials and tools in the rainy season. Yeah. Probably. So we have not been able to see the clay to be in Polk County yet. However, they are it's kind of like it's been a while, and it's been a very long time. So, I would have loved to brought them all over to you guys, because I think we both have this really wonderful county that I can't take it out of my quarantine area. So pictures are all I got for you.